I got a cake mix, I got a bottle of scotch, and a really weird jewelry making kit. So what are we doing first?
Wake up, you've been replaced.
Paige didn't ditch me.
Don't send your kids to private school. All kids that go to private school turn into conservative douchebags.
Tim went to private school.
I did, and I am a douchebag.
I'm not saying I will have sex with him, but I think he would like it.
Why are we having this conversation? He's a terrible kisser.
I'm the monster in your mind.
So does my dad get out and stay with him?
You don't see me working.
Why didn't you come find me?
I've been busy. I told you about coming around here.
Coming for wrestling practice if you so nosy.
I never heard no girls wrestling on no boys team.
Come see for yourself.
Next up,
put in a place, man.
Looks like we got ourselves a new start.
Sometimes I feel so invisible. I wonder if I'm here at all.
You are.
I think you're gorgeous. I want to get to know you better.
Olivia Newman and Susanna Fogel.
Oh, yes, we coordinated this.
It was not by accident. Okay, so Olivia went to School of the Arts and Susanna went to Columbia College. So I'm going to rewind and start at the beginning and ask, when you graduated, what was your plan to take Hollywood by storm? And I'm sure it was a moving target, but how did you finally start getting traction?
Well, I graduated about 6 months pregnant and went back to the job I had been at before graduate school because I needed health insurance. So I didn't have the best plan. But I did, when I graduated Columbia, I actually stayed an extra year to finish working on the feature script that I wanted to accompany the short film that was also called First Match. So I took an extra year to finish that script with in mind that I needed a feature to go with the short film, which was sort of a proof of concept for the feature. And it took 4 years between the writing of that script and taking it through different labs and then kind of applying to different labs before we actually shot the movie. But the goal was always, I knew I needed to make a feature before any other doors were going to open. So that was the plan, was to use the script and the short film to sort of get me that first feature made.
So all that time was well spent. Yes.
Yes. While having two babies.
How did you do it, Libby, though, with having two babies? Like, what was your writing schedule for this feature? I'm just curious.
I'm looking at my husband who's was incredibly supportive through all of that. Those were the hardest years. Those were the absolute hardest years. We were piecing it together. My husband is also a musician, and we had our first baby, and we were literally cobbling it together for those years. I would say that the thing I did was I just always set certain goals. So I had applied to the Sundance Labs while I was in graduate school with a different script. Didn't get in, but had then got a sort of the personal connection to Elise McKimmy, who is the reason that Susanna and I are friends, because she then introduced us years later. And once I had a direct line to Elise, she would check in with me at every deadline and say, are you ready to resubmit? Do you have a new script? So I kept those deadlines in mind of, I need to get a new draft of this by, you know, October, because that's when the next deadline is, or by March for the spring deadline. And so I would just set those goals. And then I had producers from Columbia who I was working with, and we would apply to every independent film lab that exists. And we ended up, after we got into the Sundance Labs, we ended up starting getting into all of those IFB film independent, you know, then all the doors started opening. And so eventually the film, because it got into some of those labs, started to garner attention from, you know, outside of Columbia, outside of our little Columbia bubble. And it got the attention of a producer who was starting his own production company, had been working for Nina Jacobson for years and was looking for a first film to kind of to produce under his own name. His name is Brian Unkelis. And he read the script coming out of Sundance and said, can I help produce this? And he had some really great relationships and got us into a bunch of meetings in LA with different production companies, and eventually basically begged Netflix to help to finance a movie. He was making another huge Will Smith movie with Netflix at the time that had like a $90 million budget. And he said to our executive producer, this movie will cost you what craft service line item is on the Will Smith movie. Just give her the money. And really, that's what did it. And at the time, Netflix had a mandate that to finance as many of these $1 million and under budget movies. And we just happened to get in the door at the right time when they were still had this a truly independent wing. And so we were part of that. I think it only lasted like 2 or 3 years. We were part of that moment when they were financing indie films.
Okay, well, right place at the right time. I love it. And Susanna, what about you?
What was the original question? How did I?
What was your initial plan? And then
my plan.
And then how did you start gaining traction?
I don't want to depress everyone with the gap between my initial plan and the amount of time it took to gain any traction.
It's heartening to know.
I like to share the struggles, of which there are many, just because I think it brings us all together in the pain that is this industry. at Columbia, I had made some short films. I'd made some short films as a teenager. I started just like making them on video in my kitchen with my friends, and just I was obsessed with seeing independent films, and I subscribed to all the in-print movie magazines, Movie Line and Premiere, and I would read them obsessively. And I was like, I'm going to be the only woman in one of these magazines one day. I started making short films. And then when I was at Columbia, I became a writer on The Varsity Show. I don't know if you guys know what that is. It was this cultish sketch comedy musical, school tradition. That was to this day, my closest friends from Columbia are my Varsity Show friends. But for 2 years, I was one of the writers. And that sort of taught me that I had a love for collaborating and for comedy. And even though I had sort of thought, because I was doing internships in like the mid 90s at places like Good Machine and, Fine Line, I thought I was going to just try to write and direct independent film, like dramedies or dramas. But then there was this big sort of more like populist sketch comedy writer's room vibe that I experienced at Columbia. And then I thought, okay, I'll still try to aspire to make those movies, but maybe along the way I can try to get a job as a TV like sitcom writer. This was in 2002 when there were like lots of network comedies and there wasn't streaming, and it was like you're going to try to get a job on, I don't know, Friends or That 70s Show or something. So I wrote a lot of specs, and people don't really do that anymore, spec episodes of things. But yeah, so I came out here the day I graduated. I drove out here in a U-Haul with my best friend, and we didn't have the money to stay anywhere, so we did the drive in 4 days, and we only stayed where we knew people that would let us stay there for free. So at one point we drove 1200 miles at a stretch without stopping. We just took shifts from Dallas to LA. But anyway, so I got here, and then I spent a year as an assistant to a TV executive because I happened to like luck into that, meeting someone who knew someone who knew someone. And I didn't know what else to do. I was like, I've got to write, and I guess I should plug myself into the industry in some way. But I found that job to be really stifling because the hours were long and it was like too emotionally intense for a day job. Like I wasn't getting any writing done because I was like too hooked into all my boss's neuroses and wanting to make sure she liked me. And it was really stressful. So I'd get home it was a, you know, 9 a.m. to 7:30 p.m. job. And then I just didn't have any energy to write. And so I only lasted a year. Also, I was a really bad assistant, but I only lasted 1 year. I only lasted 1 year, and then I decided to try to get a job I just signed up with a temp agency where they're like, your job is from 8 to 4 at answering phones at, you know, this hedge fund or whatever. And that was easier because I had taken a sketch comedy writing class and I met someone there. I mostly took the class to meet friends. I didn't know anyone. I wanted to meet other people that wanted to be writers. And the first day of the class, I made eye contact with one girl in the class at the expense of an annoying person in the class. And then we became best friends because we were like making fun of all the same people in the class. We started seeing movies together, and then we'd see bad movies together and be like, that got made, like we could do that. And then we started writing together. And anyway, so four or five years of having bad day jobs where we would get on Instant Messenger and like write together and write specs together. Later, we got our first job as writing partners. We got a manager because we made a short. No, that's not true. We wrote a feature and I made a trailer for the feature. Like I saved up all this money at my receptionist job. And I was like, I'm going to make a trailer and show everyone how good it is. And then they'll make the movie.
How much did that cost approximately?
I think I saved like $4,000, okay. Which was a lot.
Yeah.
But it was enough for like a 2-minute, 3-minute. But I was like, this has to be expensive. I want to use like 35mm. So I called AFI and I said, like, if I paid for it, are there people here at the AFI grad school that would like help me do this at a really high level that would want it on their wheels? Mm-hmm. And so I got introduced to like people from the producing program there. And then my roommate from the summer before college, a roommate I had in New York, who was like in the cinematography program there, shot it. And she's like gone on to be like, now she's a director, but she was the first female Oscar nominee for cinematography. But anyway, whatever. At the time we were like 24-year-old idiots. And so she shot this thing for me. And somebody who was in it, who was just a friend of a friend, had a roommate who was the assistant to a producer who introduced me to my manager, who is still my manager now after all this time.
That's amazing.
Wow. So it was like, you just never know. We just were making stuff. And then someone happens to see the thing and that's the thing. I don't know if that answered the question. Just making stuff ourselves. I don't know.
Okay, I love that. So I'm going to talk about your first films. And Liv, you touched a bit about how difficult it was getting it off the ground. But how did you, so First Match tackles a lot of issues. It's about a woman in the foster care system. She's a female wrestler going against males. And then she has this very fractured father relationship. So what was it? So you wrote this as an original short that you wrote that you built out into a feature. So what was it that drew you to this story, and how did you build it out from that short into a feature?
So before I went to graduate school, I worked for a documentary film company called Women Make Movies, and I worked in distribution and marketing, and we sold films that were made and directed by women. And I happened to work on a documentary called Girl Wrestler that followed this period of time where this young girl wrestler who was in eighth grade and was amazing and went all the way to states and was wrestling boys and was incredible, the top of her game, but she was in Texas, and in Texas, starting in high school, girls and boys are full contact co-ed sports are not allowed. So, and because there were not enough girls wrestling to form their own leagues, she could be on the boys team, but she could only wrestle if there happened to be a girl in her weight class on the other team. And so she was basically looking down the barrel of her wrestling career stopping in high school because of this law. And so I just started thinking about, well, who is this girl who is willing to get on the mat and wrestle boys in high school at a time when, you know, there's so much social pressure and just, you know, all of the insecurities that I felt as a high schooler. And I had been middle school athlete and stopped in high school because of my own insecurities. And I'd always been on the boys teams and then suddenly felt awkward competing against boys. So I just started thinking about who would that character be? And she kept, when I went to graduate school, she kept showing up in all of these scripts. So I'd write a script about something completely different, and there just happened to be a girl on the boys wrestling team, like side character. And so when I was thinking about what I wanted to do for my thesis. I thought, I'm going to get this out of my system. I'm just going to write a short film that explores the experience of being on a boys team. But I didn't know anything about wrestling. So I went out into the New York City public school wrestling community, and I tracked down every girl that was wrestling on a boys team. And there were about 30 of them at the time. And I would go to the matches, and I'd talk to the parents in the stands, and I'd interview the girls and their coaches. And I really like embedded myself in the New York City wrestling community. And then I also, in the back of my mind, was scouting, right? Because I knew I needed to a wrestler.
Were they very open to talking to? Because you're just like, hi, I'm Livy, and I'm
fighting
a movie. Like, you know, did you have any resistance?
No, they were all pretty, I mean, you know, it's unusual that someone just takes an interest in the thing that you happen to be interested in. They all came to the sport for really different reasons and all had very different stories. Most of the time it was a father that wrestled that introduced them to it, or an older brother, or right. And sometimes it was just a coach at the school that encouraged them because they were trying to build out their wrestling teams. So I ended up anyway, forcing all of these girls to audition for me. I got a coach to sort of become a producer of the movie and help me cast it by forcing all the girls to audition. And I cast this young wrestler from Brownsville neighborhood in Brooklyn. And we made this short film together. And as we were making the short, and she and I became very close, and we were traveling with it to festivals, and she would love to gossip with me and tell me about what was going on with her friends. And I really started to get involved with her and her teammates. And there was another girl on her team who was in foster care, lived with a foster mother, and had a really kind of not great home situation. And she was always super bubbly and upbeat around me and at practices, and would flirt with the boys and then wrestle with them. You know, it's this great dynamic. But I happened to be at a practice one day when I saw a different side of her, where she was really angry and snapping at everybody. And I asked her coach what was going on. And he told me that she had just found out that day that her grandparents were not going to adopt her. And it was the first time I even knew she had blood relatives who could adopt her. And so I think for me, Lewis Cole at Columbia used to talk about like the generative image for your script. And for me, that was this generative punch in the gut of, this is the story. This is a girl who is so desperate for family, and she is looking for it and sort of inadvertently finds it on this team. But what she really wants and craves is that unconditional familial love. And so I had that in my mind while we were making this short. And I, you know, just from having spent all this time with all these kids and in this community, I knew I had more for a feature script. And so that's then after I made the short, I switched my concentration at Columbia to screenwriting and stayed an extra year to then write the feature that really looked beyond just the experience of being a girl on an all boys team and looked more at this sort of family dynamic that I was interested in.
Well, that is so beautiful. Thank you for sharing with us, Libby. So, Susanna, I loved Life Partners. That movie has aged very well, I think. If anyone hasn't seen it yet, go watch it after tonight, immediately. And then subsequent to Life Partners, you wrote The Spy Who Dumped Me, starring Kate McKinnon, who's also Columbia College. And I love these two movies because best friends are at the center. And even though there are romantic relationships in it, the real love story is between the two women. And so I wanted to ask you, obviously this is a theme that really resounds to you. What is something unique to a best friendship you've had that maybe you layered into one or both of these movies?
I mean, it's funny. All of the first script, like not only were those two movies about best friendships, but all of my like graveyard of unproduced scripts are also about best friends. not all, but many. I think for me, it's just that I was not. I think when you go through your 20s and into your 30s, and you're not
in a community where you're like, got to get married and have kids right away, you don't really pick your romantic partner. Like, you have years and years where you have other partnerships that you find, and those are kind of like your de facto husband, wife. I mean, you kind of just attach yourself to your best friend, and that's your chosen family, chosen whatever. And so there's like a lot of intensity to that, that I think so many movies and shows, it's you traditionally, it's like there's the sidekick, the friend's the sidekick, and they kind of, they're really invested in the character's love life because the script needs them to be, you know, but not because it feels like a real friendship that's lived in. So I just, but meanwhile, it's like my friend's dramas in our 20s and 30s often had to do with like, you know, a friend breakup is so painful. It's just as painful as a real breakup, sometimes more. You know, friendships are like much more, some of them are much more enduring than romantic relationships through your life. So there's just like an emotional weight to them that, and a codependency and all of that, that that I thought, I just didn't see enough movies about that for how much it was going on in my like group of friends. And so that's something that I just always wanted to bring into like movies and stories. And also I think just the fact that there's something like really joyful about watching best friends interact, like their secret languages and how funny they are, and how sometimes they are the only people that think they're funny. And you know, that's so enjoyable to watch. Like I will watch best friends go on any journey. And those movies you mentioned are two very different ones in the sense that In Life Partners, the crux of the conflict is that there are two best friends who are approaching 30, and they're both they've been each other's person forever, and then one of them meets somebody and the other one doesn't, and it sort of like triangulates the two of them, and it kind of drives a wedge in the friendship, but it's also about growing up and growing apart. And so that conflict is like the conflict that is the axis of the movie. Whereas in Spy Who Dumped Me, the concept that my friend David and I were writing was basically like, you know, what happens if two best friends get dropped into a situation where they're basically finding themselves in like an action movie, but they're like the Broad City Girls, or what if you just put them in a movie and, but they're still friends and they still are themselves. And the reason I bring up it, it's the differences is that we did not want to have them have conflict, because to us, we're like, the conflict is that they're getting like shot at by armed gunmen on bikes. Like, we don't need them to be like, but that thing in seventh grade, I'm so mad at you, I'm gonna like walk away and get killed myself, you know? So that was the studio kept kind of saying like, there's such like a canon of movies about friends who like around page 75 have like some horrible fight. And we were like, not in this movie, like just let them just be each other's person. And I'm so glad that we like, that was our one fight that we just like would not relent about, because we just, that friendship just being joyous and like close and all the things it is, it's all you need. So anyway, that one was like not showing the cracks in a friendship, but showing how a real buddy comedy between two women was the point of that one.
Yeah. Amazing. Well, I love that. So regarding your first films, it's so difficult to get your first film made, and I feel like doubly so as first-time directors. So how did you actually get the financing for your movie? And I know you did touch a little bit on it, Libby, but so that is my question. Because, and the budget was it $1 million approximately for both of your first films?
Mine was less.
Okay.
It was, ours was 1.2.
Oh, okay.
And how many days?
22.
Okay. We did 19, but your accomplishment is still really impressive.
I'm trying to think of it. So you haven't said, I mean, we spent 3 or 4 years applying to grants, and not, you know, so I'd have like a little money to stretch, and and just knocked on every door. And when Brian came on, our producer, you know, I flew out here for a week and went to meetings with all these different financiers and production companies, and every single one of them said no. And I remember when we had sent the script to Netflix and their big budget department, and we all were like, this is not a $20 million movie. Like, you know, we knew that it didn't belong there, but they held on to it for months. And so we were approaching our drop dead date. Like, if we don't have the money by this date, we can't go. And they finally kicked it downstairs. And I remember we came up with this plan to tell the producer at Netflix that I was going to be in town. I was living in New York. Livy's going to be in town next week if you want to meet on that script that, you know, you got last week. And so we just said that, and then we set the meeting, and then I bought my plane ticket. But it was, you know, that was kind of
helpful. I love the machinations that have to happen.
And then we set the meeting on a day where my producer already had a lunch scheduled with him. So we met and I pitched, and then he went to lunch with him. And that's when he said, just, you know, this is going to cost you no money. Just do it. And you know, I don't know why Matt Levin, thank you, Ian Brick. I don't know why they decided that this was the one. The other thing, I guess the other piece of it was that we had been trying to cast the father. We knew that Mo was going to be a was going to be a young actress, unknown actress. So the father was always was the big name. And there were like literally three Black actors that were considered of value for a $1 million budget. I mean, it was, and I knew all three of those guys had no interest in doing an indie film. They had done that 20 years prior. You know, it was like their career was so past that. And I remember I had been, the script had been in this Columbia screenwriting competition. And one of the people who was on the panel, the jury, loved the script and reached out to me, and we had coffee. And he said, my girlfriend is a manager and she reps this guy who's just out of Yale. He hasn't, you know, he's shooting The Get Down right now for Netflix, but no one has seen him yet. His name is Yahya Abdul-Mateen. I'll get her to send you his audition tape. He had done all these audition tapes for these big movies. I'll get her to send you his stuff. Just see, I have a feeling he's your guy. And I saw Yahya's auditions for Fences and for all these other movies that he hadn't gotten cast in, but he was exactly what I had been looking for. So when I met with Matt, I said, by the way, we're waiting for Anthony Mackie to pass so that we can offer this to Yahya. And they actually loved it because he was doing a show for them. So there was some cross, you know, pollination there. So anyway, it just happened that because he was doing this Netflix show, it actually appealed to Netflix, and it probably wouldn't have appealed to anybody else because he was a complete unknown. So anyway.
And then he became Morpheus. Yes.
How did I get my first movie financed? Okay, so I should tell it. Can I tell a sad story first about a movie that didn't get financed that I thought was going to get financed? Okay. So the first script that I wrote that sort of started getting me like an agent, jobs, whatever, was for 5 years a struggle that we tried to get that movie made. And it kept falling apart and coming together and falling apart. And finally, we got it financed. And then a month before we started shooting, the company lost all of their money. And then it fell apart again. I had to move my sad stuff out of the production office in a box. But anyway, so that had happened over and over. And to the point where I just had like lost faith that anything ever happened ever. And I'd never had anything made, and I would like go home at Thanksgiving and just feel so like lame with my family trying to explain that I did have a career, but no, they couldn't watch anything. So then a friend of mine who was had produced some theater in New York, she had a few writer directory types that had this problem. So it was like me and three others, who were all in the same boat, where we were like, we write so much and we technically were like paid to write, but we've never had anything made and we feel really frustrated. We also have met all these actors who like can't get things financed, but they're so good and they went to Juilliard or they did these little movies, but we can never cast them even if we wanted to. And so she suggested that
we all write one act plays. She's like, I'll find a theater. You can put the actors in, you can write and direct one act plays. We'll just do it for five Mondays. And it'll just be whatever. And it, just to do something. So that became this like play series so Life Partners came from a 20-page play that we directed.
So cool.
It was so much fun, actually, because we just got a chance to see. It was really validating because people came to the plays, and it was like a lot of like assistants and junior executives and people that were friends with like our peers, but then they would tell their bosses or they'd tell whoever. So by the end of it, like people were coming to the plays, and we would just get to see our work like up there. We got to work with actors. We got to see people laughing at things that were funny and being emotional at things that, you know, we were like, we are good. Like, we can do this. We're not crazy. It was so validating. And then similar to Livy's story about buying the plane ticket, we had someone from the Sundance Lab attending the plays. And he said, your play would be like a good thing to send to the Sundance Lab. Like, have you guys thought about adapting it? Like, the deadline's really soon. We're like, yeah, we have a script. Like, we're totally ready to submit it. We did not. And then we spent like 2 or 3 weeks, you know, just like writing as fast as we could. We're like, we have nothing to lose. We're just going to try. And we happened to get into the labs. I say this having been rejected by the labs with like many, many other projects before and since. So it's not that easy, but this one happened to like get in. And then after the labs, you know, we did like IFP, the Sundance machine, like they're like, do you want to do this IFP thing where it's like a speed dating for financiers or like whatever. So we got like a little bit of money from this company, New York based financier. And then we were in the situation where I was working on a TV show. Like, I had written a pilot for a show that was like one of my unproduced things. And it was like the behemoth of the network. And they were like, we might pick up your show, so you can't make this movie. Because we might need you to work on our thing, but they wouldn't give me a guarantee of that. So I had to sort of like, and they wouldn't release me to do this movie legally. So I was like, I couldn't do either. Like, they weren't going to sign something saying whatever. It was like complicated with the legality of actually finally making this movie that I had the money for with this big like network. And finally I went to drinks with a friend, and she was like, what would a dude in the situation do? He would just be like, I'm just gonna do it all, and you're gonna deal with the details, you know. So he's like, oh, but what if someone's mad at me for whatever? So she was like, what would a dude do? And she's like, the dude would just say uh-huh and just blow. They would, she'd be like, yeah, totally, like, I hear you, network, like, I'm not gonna do it, and then just do it. And then by the time they get there, you know, but by the time they get it together, there's no conflict. There never really is. Like, they say there is one, but we talk about this all the time. It's like, oh my God, what if this person thinks this is happening on the same day? It never happens on the same day. So I went and made that movie. And by the time it was our last day of filming when I heard that the show, what like was going forward, so that I would, that was my first thing I was going to have to do. It wasn't a problem, but it did take that moment of being like, oh no, it's taken so many years for me to get a movie financed. Like, I have to do it. Right. There's no question, you know? Yeah. And it worked out in the end, but yeah, that was stressful, really stressful, you know?
Yeah. This is a good friend who gave you that advice.
Yeah. It was like, what if people are mad at me was like my main concern. And then in the end, no one was mad at me.
Was it a problem? So I wanted to talk about directing studio features. A really cool parallel between the two of you is that you both went after and landed coveted director's jobs for very well-known IP. And Susanna, obviously we saw your clip from Cat Person, which was based on the viral New Yorker story. And on a podcast, you had said, with your credits on The Spy Who Dumped Me and Flight Attendant, you weren't an obvious choice. And then Livy with Where the Crawdads Sing, which is of course the Hello Sunshine produced movie. You had only one feature credit under your belt, and your reps on a DJ podcast, you said your reps had said you better knock this pitch out of the park, and you joked, oh, maybe I'll just forget it then. But luckily for us, you did not. And so I wanted to talk to you about your creative identity and selling your vision And how did you approach pitching yourself for these movies? And what do you think it was about your voice that did break through?
It is true that when they were speaking to directors for Where the Crawdads Sing, my agents reached out to the producer, and she just said, you know, she's done one indie, like she'd have to blow it out of the water. And I did. I just had that feeling of like, there's no point, like the amount of work it's going to take to put the pitch together. And I don't even know what that means. You know, I hadn't done that many pitches, but, you know, I don't know what that means to blow that out of the water. And honestly, I think that, and I credit Columbia, and the reason I chose Columbia Film School over other film schools, was attracted to Columbia Film School over other film schools, was because they have such a strong writing program. And I went into the pitch with a very clear idea of what the script movie version of this book needed to be. And the script, how we ended up structuring it, is very different from how the book is structured. But I went in with an outline, like a you know, first act, second, and this is what the present storyline is, and this is what we're seeing in the flashbacks. And here, you know, I kind of did it almost a writing presentation, even though I wasn't pitching to write it, but I was sort of, and so I think that they hadn't heard the story cracked yet. I saw, you know, on the Zoom, them all lean forward because of that. And, you know, I put together a deck and images, and then, of course, you know, I've seen other friends who also pitched on it have shown me their decks, and they're all identical. You know, I had to talk about my vision and everything, but I really think that there was something about, you know, how I sort of cracked the story and the structure of the script that was what they were looking to hear. And sometimes it's just that. It's that you're answering some question that it may have not even known that they were trying to sort out. So in that case, I think that's what it was. And in the meeting, I will say, at the beginning of the meeting, said, you know, Livy, you've done this one movie about a girl wrestler set in Brooklyn, this urban drama, you know, and she's sort of saying, what does it have to do with Where the Crawdads Sing? And I said, honestly, I feel like it's the same exact story. They're both coming of age stories about young girls who are desperate for connection and family, who are overcoming incredible obstacles, who discover about themselves that they have this particular skill set and strength. And not only do they learn how to survive, they learn how to thrive. It's just a different setting. Like, one is set in Brownsville in, you know, current day, and the other set in the, you know, marshlands of North Carolina in the 60s and 70s, but it's the same story. And that was also a moment where I saw, you know, them being able to see the connection that it's not like every movie I make needs to be set in the same location, and, you know, but that obviously the thing that links me is I'm attracted to these stories of young women who we haven't seen doing these heroic things in a way we haven't seen before. And so they needed to have those sort of dots, you know, connected.
They were like, they're leaning forward still. It all worked out.
Yeah. Were you asking, in my case, do you mean cat person, because it was IP?
Oh, yes. I was specifically asking about cat
person. Yeah, I mean, so for that one, I mean, I think similar to what Livy's saying, it's like, it's hard because when you do something, people assume that's the only thing you can do because you did it. And then if you do something else, then they just look at the last thing you did and they're like, that's the only thing you can do. I'm like, no, I can do other things. But but you have to just keep proving that over and over. And I think, I don't think that that's like all sexism. I think that women do get that more than guys. Like, I think that there's a little bit more of the benefit of the doubt that a man can like have contained multitudes in his like talents and what he's interested in. And there's a little more like you have to kind of just push the box open more. But if you're a woman, but I do think that
that for me, yeah, every time I've always really admired directors who, whatever the assignment is, they execute it really well, but the assignment is really different from movie to movie. So, you know, like the Curtis Hanson, David Fincher, Danny Boyle, like mostly men to point to as people who've done that. But it's like, for in the case of Curtis Hanson, the person who did In Her Shoes, an incredible romantic comedy with Cameron Diaz, also did LA Confidential, also did 8 Mile, also did, you know, so it's like, that's the kind of director that I want to be. But it's really hard to show people that you are that, because they need to figure out what you are first for so long that you have to keep adding to the constellation of things that they will see you as. So I think by the time with Catperson, I think if you're somebody who has done comedy at any point, I always want people that see me as a comedy person to know that I can be serious and have depth. And then I always want serious people to know that I'm funny if they don't. So it's like, it's always really stressful for me. Cause I'm like, I just need you to know I can do this other thing. Also, and now I've done a lot of things over the years. And so where I don't have to like push that narrative as hard. It's like, people can just look and see that I've done that. But with Catperson, it was an elevated, like, New Yorker story. It was a really intellectual writer doing adaptation. I have done things about, you know, women and young women. I had shot The Flight Attendant, but it wasn't out yet because it was COVID. So my last credit was Spy Who Dumped Me. And then there was a show called Utopia that was a Gillian Flynn show that I did a couple of episodes of, but that wasn't out. So it was like, I didn't have any proof that I was not just the Spy Who Dumped Me person. And like, that's a big comedy with like a funny title that I didn't really want to be the final title, but that's a story for another panel. But yeah, like basically people are like, oh, she does big broad stuff. And so I really like had to work hard to show that I had like the nuance and gravitas and understanding of that short story. But what Livy was saying about like, it kind of does come down to the story. It's like when you show pitch decks that are just, they're usually images that are the same references as other people's decks, you know, like you're going to have lyrical Terrence Malick-y pictures for your crawdad's deck. You're going to have, you know, the same images of genre and horror movies for the Catperson deck, cause it had a horror element. So I think it really like, but in my experience, like the way to get over the line in those meetings is to help them picture the movie, which is actually not about the visuals. It's that has to be there too. But like, it's really about, I think, talking about the themes in a dramaturgical way and in an emotional way and a character way where people are like, oh, they really see it. Oh, I see what they're telling me to see. Like that person's going to be able to like execute that. Even if the actual path to executing it is so hard and like not totally clear how you're going to do it when you're in the meeting, you can like, you just have to speak intellectually about story. I think, I mean, in my experience, that's the meetings that go the best are the ones where you've kind of put on your writer hat or your producer hat and you're like, this is great. This is what I think the theme is. This is a way we can show that theme. But you kind of just have to like pitch back to them the movie that they want to make and why. And so for Catperson, the subtext of my like meeting was, I'm serious. I'm a rigorous enough filmmaker to make this complicated multi-genre thing with subtlety, and I'm not going to make it like a dumb comedy. But the text of it was like talking about the themes and the characters and like what's interesting about it. And like analytically, you know, so it was kind of like script analysis more than it was look at the lighting in this other person's movie that I got a screenshot of.
Oh, wow. I love it. But it's very fascinating that both of you, it went back to the writing and making sure that you could interpret the screenplay and you understood the screenplay and the structure of what was happening. So I think, and it, I didn't expect a similar answer. So that was great. So I wanted to turn to directing for television. So Livy, you recently directed the pilot of The Last Thing He Told Me and also 3 other episodes, and you were also the co-EP of that project. And Susanna, we talked about the fact that you directed The Flight Attendant. You directed 2 episodes, including the pilot. And so pilots are obviously very tricky because you're setting the tone, you're setting the world. Also, both of these shows are based on New York Times bestselling novels, so you have the fan base to answer to. Did you think about that, or how did you approach your, you know, tackling the pilot?
You have a lot more pilot experience.
No, you just, let me hear your answer.
Oh. Okay. I think, you know, I haven't done a pilot of a piece of material that was like, whether or not that was like cultishly obsessed over. Like, I haven't done the pilot of like a Star Warsy thing or something where like you're either totally putting on blinders to or too aware of like what the fans want it to be. And I've avoided doing that because that really intimidates me. And there's something about that feels like it would really stress me out. I think it's just about, it sort of feels like making a little movie, you know, it's like you have to making a little movie with more resources, but less time. I just approach it the same way in that sense. But with Flight Attendant, it was pretty different from the book, actually. And moving away from the book helped it as a show, just because the person who wrote the adaptation really pushed it in a sort of a weirder, more psychological place, and a little bit less of like, it was like a more of a pulpy novel. And he was like, I want this to be more of a noir, like De Palma type of thing, mm-hmm. Hitchcocky weird. So like the references were different. Pilots are hard because people are constantly asking you to tell them what the tone is, like to describe what a tone is. And that's really hard. It's like describing what's funny about a joke. It's like impossible. and you have to just keep having meetings where they're like, what's the tone? What's the tone? And it's hard to sell it in a way that makes people they have to just trust you that the tone's going to be fine. And until you've done it a couple times, like they don't. So you're just, everyone's so anxious about if it's a tone, that's not one thing only. But yeah, so I guess the challenge is like calming people down about their investment, which is like the challenge of every type of filmmaking. But I think that the hard thing about pilots is really just that you don't ever have enough time, and also the committee nature of it, which is a little bit different. Like if you're directing TV, episodic is even, you have even less agency. But if you're a director, like you're of a movie, you're the boss of the set, basically. Like you still have investors, but like you're the boss. And on a TV pilot, like you're not, the writer's your boss, but also they're relying on you to, it's like there's more of a managerial component to it because you are an employee and the boss, but not, I don't know if you find that too. It's just, there's always a bit of the hierarchy is like more confusing. And that's like something to, that's something that's just challenging. It's challenging to like put your stamp on something, but also you're there to service the vision of the writer because you're going to leave after you do an episode or four episodes. Like then it's going to be their show. And I think trying to like execute what they want and bring your own stuff into it and like not have the ego that you need to have on a feature on a TV show, because it will not go as well. But having enough ego to do a good job.
Perfect.
The last thing you told me, the author of the book and her husband were the showrunners.
Oh, wow.
So, and the husband, Josh Singer, Academy Award winner, Laura has written many best-selling books. So they were these two superstar writing couple. I felt like the kid with parents. But I also felt like no one loves that. This is their baby. No one loves this material as much as they do. It's her book. And Josh, you know, was just wanted to do right by his wife's book. So in that way, it was wonderful because I felt like, okay, well, I know my bosses love this more than anyone, the way that I will love something as the director of a movie, like it's my baby. The challenging thing about that show is it takes place, the first two episodes are set in Sausalito and then it goes to Austin.
But we didn't shoot Sausalito until we had finished shooting all seven episodes. Our last week of shooting was in Sausalito. So my pilot and I did the first two episodes, and half of the footage was missing because we hadn't shot it yet.
Mm-hmm.
So the tricky part was that we were getting studio notes and, you know, there were notes coming in on a half shot pilot and scenes being cut and reordered before we had all the material. So that was really tricky. But when I pitched on it, you know, I had actually, they had written all seven episodes. So I had read all seven. I had read the book. And it was what I liked about the TV adaptation was in the book, it's all told from the main character's point of view, and you only see what she sees. And in the adaptation, they had given more space to some of the other characters. And so you weren't all, you know, it wasn't as, so you were allowed to go into their head spaces. And I loved the way that memory was what they relied on to solve this mystery, and the, you know, play with how is memory triggered by an emotional thing, like something that somebody said to you that you didn't even pay attention to, when you're suddenly, you know, having having an emotional moment, you remember the way that thing was said in a completely different light. It like unlocks something. So I loved that play. And there was that. So because I had read all of the episodes, I was also able to say, okay, when we start this off and we're in Sausalito, there's a different feeling than when they arrive in Austin and they're in this city where they don't know anything. So I sort of had to have a vision for how are we photographing Sausalito and their life that they are leaving, that they really want to return to in a different way than how we film Austin, even though I wasn't shooting that much of Austin. But I knew that we needed to have that sort of language established so that when the other directors came in, I would be able to share with them what the intent was when they took over the relay. But that was, it's tricky. I mean, I was on the whole thing because I was the producing director. I was there for the whole shoot, which was, to me, the most wonderful part of that job was working with other directors, like being able to watch other directors work, because we never get to yeah. work together, really. It was tricky because then, you know, they would want me to put on a producing hat and like go in and start talking time. It's like, are you kidding? I totally understand why she's going over, because they took forever in makeup, you know. But it was really, really wonderful being able to support other directors and hear their ideas and just be, you know, be collaborative. So I loved that aspect of it.
So cool you got to wear two hats there. So I wanted to close out with a Columbia question, which was, did you have a favorite course or professor that was especially meaningful to you from our school?
Okay. There are two. I had my favorite directing class was my first year. I had a directing class with Eric Mendelsohn. And what I loved about it was that it was only our second semester. So we didn't know what we were doing at all. And that was great. And he encouraged us to just make a lot of stuff, shoot with phones, don't worry about how it looked. My favorite exercise I shot was I just recreated a scene from the ice storm that I loved on like this really crappy camera. And I had two of my friends who were not in film school. I shot them in their kitchen while we were visiting them in Baltimore one weekend. And because I just wanted to feel what it was to put my camera in the place that Aang had put his camera. And then how did that, you know, just learning the basics of like camera placement and movement and angle and how you use that to tell a story. It didn't matter. The lighting didn't matter, that, you know, just took the pressure off of trying to make something that was, you know, there's so much pressure in film school that every exercise is a potential festival entry. But when at the beginning of that class, when he looked over my first semester material, I had done your 3 to 5 is your first semester film, and I had done a comedy. And he sat down with me and said, okay, let's talk about your 3 to 5 and why it wasn't funny. And it was crushing. But I take that with me to this day of let's not be precious. You tried something, it didn't work. Let's figure out why it didn't work. And that was sort of, so that's what I loved about his class, was everything was an opportunity to see what worked and what didn't, period, without any kind of emotion around it. And then the other favorite course was a screenwriting class with Malia Scotch-Marmo, who taught us a different method of approaching screenwriting, which was using the sequencing method, where you break down a script into 15-page sequences. And for me, it was so helpful in not taking on 120 pages, but looking at a story in these small bits. And I still go back to that method all the time. When I start feeling overwhelmed, I just think, what's my first sequence? What's my second? Oh, you know, and her approach was just, it took this sort of mystery out of screenwriting and just gave us like these really useful tools that I go back to all the time.
And like bite size that you can achieve.
Yeah.
Yes.
I remember really liking Martin Mizell's modern drama class. I was an English major, undergrad. And then I still remember that the class that like blew my brain open was called, this is like a SNL sketch of what a, like, you know, whatever class would be called at, but the class was called in 2000, it was called Queer Diasporas in Asian American Literature. That was the name of the class. Like, it's a joke of a liberal arts education class, but it was incredible. And I took it because my lit hum, like the guy that just was like tapping in for lit hum, one of the guys that they always have, people are like, yeah, this isn't what I do, but I'm like here because I have to be. That guy was so smart and incredible and just totally like took the curriculum of lit hum and like did whatever he wanted. Like he would assign us, David Ng, that was his name, he would assign us just not what was on the he was like, I'm assuming you're going to read all the stuff you have to read. I'm going to assign you, like, I want you to watch Clueless and compare it to blah, blah. Like, he was like, that person, oh, I'm going to do this in the veil of that. Let's go to a jazz club and then talk about how it relates to whatever. So I was just like, I will take every class that he teaches. And he happened to be teaching a seminar called Queer Diasporas in Asian American Literature. So I'm like, that's my specialty now. I love that. Which was great. But I still remember, I was just like, this is, I understood when people are like, the professor that changed my life. I was like, I get that, you know, that was not a specialty I've ever returned to, but I was like, I don't care what he's teaching. This is what it means to feel like alive in the classroom and not like you're waiting for whatever the class to end, which sometimes it can feel like in classes that are not like exactly in your strike zone. But yeah, I mean, I loved being an English major. I thought I was going to major in, I was interested in majoring in religion because I didn't grow up, I'm like so casually Jewish, but not religious. And I was like, oh, religion, what's that about? Like, everyone's so into it. And so I took like different religious classes, but then, I don't know, in the end I was sort of like, I had fulfilled between the varsity show and like taking all these English classes, because it's what I actually wanted to be doing. Mm-hmm. I kind of had almost completed that major. So I just was like, let me just finish this major and then like do whatever. So I did like a lot of whatever. And I did like level one of like 5 languages and then dropped out of it. I speak rudimentary of many languages and other dilettante stuff. But also, yeah. Yeah.
For that. You got your degree.
And I did take a really interesting seminar on Randall Balmer. This he taught like an class in contemporary religions, evangelical stuff, and
wow,
it's like more like newer religions. And but he also was like a very charismatic, like hot evangelical guy. And I just also remember that class for different reasons. He had a book called Mine Eyes Have Seen the Glory, and everyone was like, they have, they're really hot. So that's the other one I liked for different reasons.
I'm sad I missed that one. Well, thank you so much for spending the evening with us and just being very honest about your own artist journey and what it's taken to get you here and your movies made. And so let's have a round of applause for Susanna and Lily.